NBC in Baton Rouge. This is WRBT Channel 33. This is 33 News with weatherman Rick Bush, sportscaster Dick Walcott, and anchor Ann LaRue.
Good evening. In tonight's news, a first compromise was reached today on the shaping of the 1980 Democratic platform. After days of heated arguing, supporters of President Carter and Senator Edward Kennedy unanimously approved the call for an eventual phase-out of nuclear power plants. The compromise is a victory for Kennedy, who's made discontinuation of nuclear plants a key campaign issue. Ironically, nuclear energy was a topic dealt with in the formal declaration emerging from the Big Seven Economic Summit in Venice. And although President Carter didn't mention the subject in his summation of the talks, he joined the other industrial leaders in calling for greater expansion of nuclear power to meet energy needs. In addition to economic issues, the summit focused on the reported Soviet troop withdrawal from Afghanistan. More from Judy Woodruff.
Although the summit's final declaration didn't mention it, it was the Allied response to Soviet aggression that captured the headlines in Venice. Yesterday, there was a joint statement calling on the Russians to get out of Afghanistan. Tonight, there was President Carter's analysis of the partial withdrawal of Soviet forces. Mr. Carter said he expected less than 10% of the 85,000 troops to be pulled out, and said those leaving were troops that had not seen action in several weeks or months, and added that the Russians could send them back in if necessary. But today's final declaration mentioned none of that. Instead, it dealt with plans by the Allies to reduce their dependence on foreign oil by developing other sources of energy. The leaders stressed that unless they bring the price of energy under control, other economic problems cannot be solved. President Carter, in his closing statement, reminded everyone listening of the threat posed by the Russians.
The Soviet aggression in Afghanistan is a profound assault against the laws of nations and a grave threat to the stability of that vital region.
But in what appears to be a softening of administration policy, Mr. Carter said it's beneficial that the French and the Germans are talking to the Russians on their own. It's inevitable, he said, that the Soviets will talk to the Western Europeans independently. I can't prevent it, even if I wanted to. Up until now, administration officials had expressed concern that such communications would amount to business as usual while the Soviets continue, unacceptably to the United States, to occupy Afghanistan. Judy Woodruff, NBC News, Venice.
A presidential task force is recommending that the government step in to rescue the nation's battered auto industry. Detroit has been taking a beating recently from the rising cost of gasoline, the sinking economy, and a flood of foreign cars. Details of the report from Irving R. Levine.
NBC News has obtained a copy of a confidential administration report prepared for President Carter, urging quick action to save the U.S. auto industry from disaster. The report says that 688,000 workers in the auto and related industries have been laid off, and it places most of the blame on Japanese imports. The report offers the president these options: crack down on Japanese imports in one of two ways. Urge the Japanese to voluntarily cut down the number of cars exported to the U.S., or limit Japanese imports to the 1979 level of 1.6 million vehicles. Other recommendations: stimulate auto sales by making it clear to banks and the public that auto loans for consumers are exempt from recent credit restrictions. Provide government loans to auto dealers who have been going bankrupt this year at four times the rate of recent years. Relax some environmental and safety regulations for automakers. Transportation Secretary Neil Goldschmidt, who headed the cabinet group that prepared the report, says the auto layoffs could hurt the president's reelection chances.
I think the political implications are very dangerous for any administration that sees a lot of people out of work and bitter and in a situation where they're frustrated and they don't know what they can do about it.
President Carter can take action on the recommendations without the approval of Congress, and he is expected to do so quickly. Irving R. Levine, NBC News, the Capitol.
A spokesman for Representative John Anderson's independent campaign for president says they will start their drive to get Anderson on the ballot here in Louisiana in the next few weeks. Secretary of State Jim Brown says Anderson's campaign will have to get 5,000 signatures from registered voters to get on the ballot. 800 signatures must come from each of the 8 congressional districts. Brown doesn't believe Anderson will have a big campaign effort here in the state.
I don't think Anderson looks on Louisiana as a state that he can carry. I think he wants to make a good faith effort and be on the ballot. from what I've read and from what I can observe, Anderson is going to zero in on 15 or 20 states. Louisiana will not be one of the major states he'll go after, but he does want to make a good faith effort to go on the ballot and have a campaign down here.
More people are writing bad checks than ever before. Economists say it's a sign of the times. Money is difficult to come by, but checks are easy to write.
More than 400,000 bad checks worth $20 million are written every day. Some of them are made good, but many are not. Because of this, several new check guaranteeing services have sprung up all across the country.
Tall check, store code, please. Type of ID, please.
This is Telecheck, a system that makes it possible for a merchant to take a check from a customer from anywhere in the country 24 hours a day.
It's a negative database system. We guarantee checks for customers, provided they are not already in our computer files. And the only way to get in our computer file, of course, is to write a bad check and fail to make it good.
Telecheck operates in 52 major cities across the country, and the stores pay the firm a percentage of each check verified.
It saved us a lot of money.
Any estimate on how much?
75%
of all your bad checks?
Yes, or more. It saved us quite a bit.
Check writing appears to be on the increase these days because of the limits and the charges placed on most credit cards. This in turn causes another problem.
Bad checks are increasing at a rate compounded annually of 8%, which is faster than the national crime rate. But in the last 3 months, we've seen them increase at 11%, which is tied directly to the state of the economy.
This computer has the names of more than 1 million bad check writers across the country. And if the economy continues to suffer, this list is expected to grow. This is Myron Lowry reporting for NBC News.
And coming up later in tonight's news, East Baton Rouge Parish has won a state Supreme Court decision.
Monday and Tuesday are the days to save at the Cortana Mall Bargain Bazaar, an in-sidewalk sale featuring large reductions on hundreds of items. We'll be placing our merchandise on racks and tables in the mall walkways, and we'll be selling for just pennies on the dollar. So come early and save big Monday and Tuesday for the Cortana Mall Bargain Bazaar.
Tomorrow is here today at Cortana Mall.
The shopping center of the 80s.
Spencer Drawing College offers courses in secretarial, business administration, accounting, and word processing. Classes start July 7th. Call 383-7701.
Hello, everybody. Dick Walcott in sports news tonight. They broke out the strawberries and cream today in England. It was a predictable first day of action at Wimbledon. The top four seeds in the men's division all won easy matches. Top-seeded and defending champion Bjorn Borg swept past Ismael El Shafi in straight sets. Second-seeded John McEnroe had an even easier time with Butch Waltz. Number three, Jimmy Connors, rolled over Richard Lewis, and fourth-seeded Vitas Gerulaitis ran past Stefan Simonsen. Tomorrow, the women take to the court for the first round of play at Wimbledon. Light schedule of Major League Baseball action, only 6 games, 2 in the National League tonight. Rick Sutcliffe found the handle on the Houston Astros and shut them out with only 2 hits tonight. Dodgers beat Houston 3-0 at the Dome. 1-1 after a rain delay at St. Louis between the Pirates and the Cards. They've gone now into the 6th inning of that contest. They had a rain delay at the start. In the American League, 4 games, 2 finals. Detroit Tigers edging past Cleveland 5-4. The Boston Red Sox knocking off the New York Yankees 7-2. In the 7th inning, the Minnesota Twins lead the Kansas City Royals 3-1. Milwaukee at Oakland is just getting started. The pitchers are up in that game now. It's Reggie Cleveland working for the Brewers tonight, and Brian Kingman is on the mound for the Oakland A's. The Chicago Cubs were off today, but they made some roster changes. The Cubs picked up catcher Cliff Johnson from the Cleveland Indians for 2 players to be named later, but they lost third baseman Steve Ontiveros, who is signed to play in Japan. Ontiveros says he's leaving for Japan on Saturday. Well, today marks the birthday of the legendary Merle Boots Garland, assistant track coach at LSU. And he celebrated by holding a one-mile challenge run against his former athletes and some members of the media. The mile run was in conjunction with a 5,000-meter run that was held to celebrate the first anniversary of the Athletic Attic Store in Village Square. At any rate, yours truly was left to uphold the standards of the media. None of the other radio, TV, or newspaper types showed up. Let me say first that it's the first time I've run a mile in some 20 years, but run it I did. However, the old coach put on a burst of speed in the final quarter to edge me at the tape. Now, I'm not saying Coach Garland didn't run the entire distance, but the word is that from now on he'll be known as Rosie Ruiz Garland. And coming up later in sports tonight, Canadian golf, racing with the Formula cars and hydroplanes.
Rosie Ruiz Garland. Let's go to the satellite picture now. You'll see that most of the shower activity was again in the southeastern portion of the country, and those showers and thunderstorms reached from Iowa through Louisiana over the lower Ohio Valley, the Tennessee Valley, the eastern Gulf states, and the southern Atlantic coast, all the way from Florida into Virginia. Two tornadoes touched down this afternoon, one in Orlando, Florida, the second in Alma, Georgia. No reports of damage with both of those systems. A warm front, which was a stationary front, has now backed up in the form of a warm front, has passed over our state. Tomorrow we will have a return of moist southerly winds, which will produce again shower and thunderstorm activity. And to make the matter somewhat worse and more complicated, a low pressure area has developed in the Texas Panhandle, which will move slowly toward the east. Therefore, that the probability of rain will be going up as high as 30% by this time tomorrow. Over on the state map, temperatures are once again on the warm side. Here in Baton Rouge, we are partly cloudy at 81 degrees. Our relative humidity is at 82%. Winds coming out of the south at 8 miles per hour, and the barometer is steady at 29.99 inches. Our high today was 86. The low last night was 72, and officially recorded at Ryan Airport, 9/100ths of an inch of rain. The forecast for Baton Rouge reads like this: a chance of showers or thunder showers tonight and Tuesday, otherwise partly cloudy through Wednesday. The low temperature tonight and Tuesday night in the mid-70s, the high Tuesday and Wednesday in the low 90s. Winds mostly southwesterly, 10 to 15 miles an hour, except stronger and gusty in and near the thunderstorms, and the probability of rain stands at 30% for tonight and for tomorrow. And that's 33 Weather at 10. Stay tuned for Ann LaRue coming back with more news.
Now we can replace all your old windows with amazing Thermal Guard windows.
I can keep my windows sparkling clean both inside and out thanks to Thermal Guard's tilt-in sash.
No more paint, scrape, or putty for me. My Thermal Guard windows are maintenance-free.
And Thermal Guard's double panes with full one-inch air space locks in heat, locks out winter's cold, eliminates the need for storm windows, and keeps utility bills down.
At our house, we can't afford to have drafts.
Call today for a free estimate. LAS Enterprises, 383-0202.
At the legislature today, the House Ways and Means Committee killed a bill that would have added a penny tax on cigarettes. A report from Roger Sockman.
Rate $6 million a year to be used for cancer research and to study other diseases that result from smoking. Watermeyer explained to the House Ways and Means Committee it would only be a four-year tax. He added only one other state, Minnesota, has imposed this type of tax. Dr. Alton Oshner of the Oshner Clinic in New Orleans said about a third of the people in the state are smokers, and as long as they keep smoking, more money is needed for their own benefit.
It's a principal killer in men from cancer, and it's predicted that in two years, it'll be the principal killer in women of cancer. Cancer of the breast is now the principal killer. But here's a disease that is preventable, and we need more money for research.
There were some opponents to the bill, but the opponents were not against using tax money for cancer research. They said that cigarette smokers should not be the only ones to pay for the studies.
Why should the tobacco smoker alone carry this burden of cancer research when in our state, all of us sitting here know that there are problems throughout the medical profession in every area, and we do need research.
The committee voted the bill down 9-5. Some representatives said the cancer people should have gone to the Appropriations Committee instead of Ways and Means to ask for a state supplement. Representative Joel Chachon said if they go that route next year, they're going to ask not just for $6 million, but for $60 million, because that's how much is needed just to start to find a cure for cancer. Roger Sockman, 33 News.
Baton Rouge Representative Joe Delpit has quit the House Civil Law and Procedure Committee. Representative Delpit says he resigned from the panel because of differences in attitude with Committee Chairman Clark Godin. Delpit told 33 News other reasons he left the panel.
Primarily because I'm an activist, and that committee, in my opinion, is made up of a group of lawyers who seem to be trying to impress each other, and they expound and articulate about the different aspects of the law, and that doesn't interest me. And I try to get things done for my constituents, and I thought I can do a better job if I would get off of there. I must also add that additional responsibilities that I have, I was appointed on a national committee that has some very clear developments in it as it relates to things that I'm interested in.
And Delpit says he has not been appointed to another committee in the legislature. The Louisiana Supreme Court has upheld the death sentence given in Baton Rouge District Court to Colin Clark. The 28-year-old Clark was convicted last August for murdering Fred Smith, the assistant manager of the Red Lobster Inn, during an armed robbery. Smith was stabbed more than 30 times, and over $1,800 was taken from the restaurant. Clark fled the parish after the murder and was later arrested in Oceanside, California. The city parish government won a victory in the state Supreme Court today, but it may be of little consequence. 33's Cassandra McWilliams has more on the story.
The decision concerned the liquor moratorium that was approved by the council last fall. The council took that action to allow the Liquor and Beer Committee enough time to make its recommendations on possible changes in the liquor laws. The state Supreme Court did not really rule on the constitutionality of the permit freeze, but it did rule that the wrong people filed the suit against the city parish. The High Court said the State Hotel Motel Association and the State Restaurant Association had no right to file the suit because they already had liquor licenses and would not be affected by the permit freeze. The decision really has no meaning since the moratorium will expire on July 9th anyway. The Alcoholic Beverage Control Board will hold a special meeting on July 10th to consider the permit applications that have been gathered since the moratorium went into effect. 27 applications are now being processed, but only two are ready for action by the board. Cassandra McWilliams, 33 News.
Senator Russell Long says he hasn't decided exactly when he's going to announce for re-election, but he says he's definitely going to run for another term. Long was in town today for an informal news conference with some of the broadcast media. Senator Long was asked about possible opposition in the September race.
I always believe in considering any opposition to be very serious, and I always believe in running scared, and if it turns out that there really wasn't anything to be scared about, well, so much the better. It's a lot better to do it that way than just to find out at the last moment that there was something to be scared about.
Although no one has announced they're going to run against Long, State Representative Woody Jenkins, who ran and lost to Senator Bennett Johnston 2 years ago, has been said to be the most formidable candidate to oppose Long. Jenkins told 33 News today he hasn't made up his mind what he's going to do about the campaign yet.
I've got about 2 weeks to make up my mind, and I'm still looking at it very closely. I've been traveling the state, setting up some organizational meetings and organizing parish by parish, and if in a couple of weeks I think that the finances will be there and the support will be there, then I'll give it a race.
Jenkins has until July 11th to make up his mind. That day is the deadline for qualifying in the senatorial race. A group of North Baton Rouge area residents is up in arms about safety in their neighborhood. 33's John Cooper reports they took to the streets today to air their grievances.
Several residents of the Brookstown area and members of the Association for Community Organization Reform Now gathered at the intersection of St. Gerard and Enterprise Street and got busy stopping motorists. Acorn Representative Peggy David explained their motive.
What we're doing here today is trying to get somebody to get out here and to help us stop this speeding on this street. It's very dangerous. It's going to kill some children one of these days. And we're trying to get a stop sign on the street here. And they've told us that they will not give us a stop sign because they do not use stop signs as a means of speed control.
Ms. David said they plan to meet with their councilmen and other city officials in an effort to have stop signs placed at several intersections, increased police and radar patrols, and lowering of speed limits in the Brookstown area. John Cooper, 33 News.
America, TA is your radio. It's the B.F. Goodrich high-performance radio you chose over all the rest. TAs were born on the track. The TAs we race are the same great-handling TAs you ride. Cars love TA. Trucks love TA. We love TA. USA loves TA. TAs made Goodrich number one in high-performance radios.
Monday and Tuesday are the days to save at the Cortana Mall Bargain Bazaar, an in-sidewalk sale featuring large reductions on hundreds of items. We'll be placing our merchandise on racks and tables in the mall walkways, and we'll be selling for just pennies on the dollar. So come early and save big Monday and Tuesday for the Cortana Mall Bargain Bazaar.
Tomorrow is here today at Cortana Mall.
The shopping center of the 80s.
There were a couple of stories going on at the Canadian Open in Quebec over the weekend. One, of course, was the winning of the title by Bob Gilder, but the other was whether Jack Nicklaus was really back in form enough to win a title that has eluded him.
U.S. Open champion Jack Nicklaus has never won the Canadian Open. He had trouble all day. This shot went into the gallery on the 16th hole, and Nicklaus finished at 2 over 282. Leader Bob Gilder was in and out of trouble late in the round. This tee shot on 14 went into the deep rough by a tree, forcing him to pitch out and take a bogey, leaving him 7 under par. Jerry Pate came alive with a late charge. This birdie on 14 brought him to 5 under, 2 strokes behind Gilder. After a bogey on 15, Pate came back with another birdie on 16 to return to 5 under par. Gilder averted a collapse with his pitch to the lip of the cup on 17 to save par with a subsequent tap-in to remain 7 under at that point. Pate's final chance went sour on 17 when he missed the birdie. Both men bogeyed the final hole, with Gilder winning at 6 under 274. Jeff Davis, NBC News.
The Pocono 500 is one of three major races for Indy-type cars. It was held yesterday in Pennsylvania, and Bobby Unser took home the top money, nearly $75,000.
The battle for yesterday's True Value 500 was supposed to be between the Ground Effects Penske cars of pole sitter Bobby Unser and Indy winner Johnny Rutherford's Jim Hall Chaparral, but it was A.J. Foyt who grabbed the opening lead in his Gilmore Racing Special number 14. Foyt actually led five times for a total of 68 laps early in the race, but he said later that driving against the Ground Effects of Unser and Rutherford and Mario Andretti took its toll in the corners. Foyt was out with a burned valve after 85 laps.
I like to win, and I'd just soon break it and fall out leading as I would running back like we did at Indy.
That left the rest of the race open for pole sitter number 11 Unser and the yellow number 4 Rutherford to battle it out, and they did battle, and Rutherford led briefly in the straights here on lap 160. But the Chaparral team lost the war in the pits when Rutherford's car stalled in the pits on the 180th lap. He fell precious seconds behind the leader Unser, and the Norton Spirit drove on to win the race and gain revenge over the Indy winner. Unser's average speed was 151.454 miles an hour, good for $78,800 in prize money and 1,000 Championship Racing League points. Bobby Unser gets the wreath and the golden hammer and his first victory at the Pocono Raceway in the True Value 500. Kevin Lynn reporting from Long Pond, Pennsylvania.
They called it Thunder on the Ohio, the Evansville Regatta in Evansville, Indiana. And Thunder is what it was. It was racing for unlimited hydroplanes. And yesterday, Gene Chenoweth drove Miss Budweiser to victory on the 2-mile course on the Ohio River.
Three new world speed records for the unlimited hydroplanes were established at the Thunder on the Ohio Regatta. The first came on Friday in qualifications when Steve Reynolds pushed his Miss Circus boat around the course at 131.627 miles an hour. But on race day, Reynolds and the rest of the field were chasing Miss Budweiser and pilot Dean Chenoweth. The Tallahassee, Florida native had a perfect day, winning all four races. Chenoweth had one close call, though, in the second heat when defending national champion Bill Muncy in the Atlas Van Line Special cut him off. The force of the blast from Muncy's rooster tail shattered the deck and windshield on Miss Budweiser. The crew made emergency repairs with gray tape, but owner Bernie Little was worried about the damage.
Well, the whole top deck's gone. Windshield's busted. You can see what they're doing. Certainly it'll affect the running of the boat.
However, it was Muncy who had the real problems. His boat finished only two of four races, and the wing stabilizer had to be discarded because it just wouldn't stay on. Meanwhile, Chenoweth was cruising on to victory despite the damage. In the final race, he established a new competition lap speed record of 128.114 miles an hour. And his 10-mile average speed of 122.241 was also a new world mark. After taking the checkered flag, Chenoweth waved to the crowd and gave credit for the victory to his crew.
You know, what can you build better than while I'm driving? I mean, you know, you just got to give the crew and the owner so much support, and they've just built a fantastic craft, and they've just put it all together.
The final order of finish, Miss Budweiser first, followed by Miss Circus Circus and the Atlas Van Lines.
That's a beautiful...
John Stern for NBC News, Evansville, Indiana.
By the way, Ron Guidry was that loser in the Boston Red Sox 7-2 victory over the New York Yankees tonight. Two other finals now in Major League Baseball. The Cardinals beat the Pirates 6-1. Minnesota Twins beat the Kansas City Royals 4-1. U.S. Olympic basketball team beat the NBA All-Stars again tonight. That was 82-76, and that's our sports.
Finally tonight, vampires, monsters, ghouls, and the like used to be the film stars the fans were dying to see. But lately, Hollywood has opted more for Travolta than for Transylvania. But that grave situation is about to be corrected.
I am Dracula.
Vampires, monsters, ghouls, they used to be the film stars fans were dying to see. Lately, however, Hollywood has opted more for Travolta than Transylvania. Well, that grave situation is being corrected. One big studio has decided to bring our favorite fiends back to life. This is Castle Dracula, an extravagant array of special effects, robots, computer animation, the living playing the undead. It's the newest part of Southern California's popular Universal Studios tour, and a tribute to the monsters that first put Universal on the map. A way of saying, fangs for the memories. Is it frightening? Well, these tourists are not reacting to the price of gas. What part did you like about the show?
The part where that man got hung up on the door. I liked the part when he got out of his coffin.
So, if your summer vacation plans call for a trip to Southern California, you have several choices. You can take a quiet evening stroll through the park, you can go bird watching, or you can always go to the beach. And then there's Castle Dracula. For monster fans, it's simply to die for. Judd Rose for NBC News, Los Angeles.
That's the news. I'm Ann LaRue. Good night.
Save now at McPete on Chevrolet's mid-size economy cars, the 1980 Malibu and Citation. Choose from McPete's great selection of Citations with 5-passenger comfort and an estimated 24 miles per gallon city, 38 highway. The economical Malibu Sport Coupe with room for 6 is just $59.95 at McPete, with air conditioning, automatic, power steering, power brakes, and much more. Get comfort, economy, and low price on your 1980 Chevy Citation or Malibu now at McPete.
Every single item is on sale at my jewelry store this month. So come by and see why the very best jewelry is not necessarily expensive.
Are you glad there's jewels in the day?